Hello everyone, welcome to the video lecture series of operating system. In today's session, we are continuing the topic process management. Myself, Kumar Kuncha, your instructor. In this particular session, we are going to discuss the third CPU scheduling algorithm, which is nothing but a priority-based CPU scheduling algorithm. So before going to discuss a priority-based CPU scheduling algorithm, let us discuss the disadvantages of shortest job first algorithm as well as first come first serve scheduling algorithm, so that we can come to know that by having the understanding of priority-based scheduling, can these algorithm resolve the issue of your previous algorithm or not? So, in the first scheduling algorithm, which is FCFS, what was the main drawback of FCFS? It suffers from convoy effect. That is the main drawback of first-come, first-served scheduling algorithm. But in that case, there was no starvation because processor is not biased. Okay. What was the scenario of second algorithm that we have seen in the previous session? That is nothing but shortest job first. So in that case, shortest job first gives the minimal average waiting time, but main drawback of shortest job first algorithm was it is not able to implement practically. That was the main drawback of SJF CPU scheduling algorithm. So it provides a benchmark so that researcher can reach to that benchmark, okay, for implementation. Yes, so these are the pros and cons of, you know, shortest job first scheduling algorithm as well as FCFS scheduling algorithm. Now let us discuss third one, which is nothing but priority based CPU scheduling algorithm. So what is priority based CPU scheduling algorithm? So in this case, instead of considering arrival time as well as instead of considering watch time, in this case we will schedule the process based on the priority only, and priority is associated with each process in this case. So suppose set of processes we have as input, so each process has its own priority, and according to that priority number, we will schedule the process for execution. As simple as that. So no matter how much time it requires for execution, means we are not bothering about burst time to schedule the process in this case. Okay. So at any instance of time, out of all available processes, CPU is allocated to the process which poses the highest priority number, and that priority number may be higher or lower. Means there are two ways through which you can give the highest priority. Either you can consider the highest value as highest priority, or you can consider the lowest value as highest priority. So in both the cases, can consider the highest priority in various examples. So in this case, in this particular example that we are going to discuss, we will consider the highest value as highest priority. Okay? So you can consider your lowest value as highest priority as well. So it depends, you know, depends on the designer which phenomenon they have selected for implementation purpose. Okay. Now, again, if there is a tie, means in the case of HCF, if there is a tie, we have broken that tie with help of FCFS algorithm. Same way, in the case of priority-based algorithm, if more than one process have same priority number, okay, in that case, to break the priority, we will consider the FCFS, means we will consider the arrival time in that case. Whoever senior most, that would be selected for execution first. Okay. Next, there is no importance of burst time in the case of priority based CPU scheduling algorithm. So, as I told you, how much time it requires for execution, whether it is short running process or long running process, it doesn't matter for me, okay, as far as this priority based CPU scheduling algorithm is concerned. I will simply schedule the process according to the priority number only. Okay. Again, as we have discussed in SJF, it has two versions. One is primitive and second one is non-primitive. So, same in the case of priority based CPU scheduling algorithm, it has two types. One is primitive and second one is non-primitive. And you know very well the difference between primitive scheduling algorithm and non-primitive type of scheduling algorithm. So I'm not going to discuss that stuff again. Okay. So in the case of primitive, there is a chance of context switching. If there is a non-primitive algorithm, in that case there is no chance of context switching. That things will keep in mind. So let us discuss both the type of example in detail. So let us discuss first non-primitive priority based CPU scheduling algorithm first. So as far as non-primitive priority based CPU scheduling algorithm, if you have such type of input in which there are set of processes starting from P1 to P5, all the processes have its own arrival time, all the processes has its own burst time, or we can say running time, and as I told you, each process is associated with one priority number. So that priority number is given to us as an input. So according to this priority number, we will schedule that process for execution based on the highest priority that process will be scheduled first, and so on. In this way, we can schedule the process for execution. So it is somewhat, you know, simple to understand, because a separate number, separate priority number is explicitly given to us as an input. Okay. So how we can load the gain chart based on these set of inputs? Let us discuss first non-primitive priority execution in the algorithm. So initially we need to consider the arrival time. Once all the processes arrive in the ready queue, in that case, afterwards, we will not consider, you know, we will not bother about, you know, arrival time, and we will not bother about, you know, burst time as well. According to the priority number, we will simply schedule that process for execution. Means, initially, at time 0, we need to consider the arrival time first. Because, as I told you earlier, if there is no process arriving in the ready queue, there is no concept to talk about whether that process needs to be scheduled for execution or not. Okay, so first of all, it needs to reset in ready queue or in main memory, and then see if you can execute that task. Okay, so in this case, P1 arrived first because arrival time of P1 is 0. Yes, because it is not printing, so there is no concept of context switching. So once any process is scheduled for execution, it will complete its execution. Then and then we can schedule another one for its execution in the CPU. Okay, so P1 is scheduled at time 0, and how much time it requires? 4 minutes of time. So P1 would be executed up to 4 units of time, and then you need to check up to 4 units of time how many processes arrived in the ready queue. So remaining all the processes are arrived in the ready queue, and once you have these processes in the ready queue, now the task is very simple. According to the highest priority, we will schedule the process for execution. And if any two processes have the same priority number, to break this time, how we can do these things? So to break this time, we will consider the arrival time of that process, and according to the seniority, we will schedule the process for execution. So let us discuss. P1 is completed the task, yes. Now all the process arrived at time 4, yes. Now P2, P3, P4 and P5. Now we need to check these 4 processes priority number. So P2 has 3 priority number, P3 has 4 priority number, P4 and P5 has same priority, 5. And it is the highest priority because we have considered the highest number as highest priority. So we have 2 choices to do it. So there is a tie. So if you want to break this tie, you need to check the arrival time. So what is the arrival time of P4? 3. And what is the arrival time of P5? 4. So which one is near most? P4. So P4 will be scheduled for execution first. So P4 is executing for how much time? 5 minutes of time. Okay. At unit time, again, P4 and P4, P1 and P4 is completed its execution. Now what are the remaining processes? 3 processes we have, and out of 3, P5 is the highest priority, so P5 would be scheduled for execution. And how much time it requires? 2 units of time. So 9 plus 2 is equal to 11. So up to 11, P5 would be executed. Okay. Now we have 2 choices. One is P2 and another one is P3. So P2 and P3, which contains the highest priority number, P3. Yes, so P3 requires 1 unit of time. So 11 to 12, P3 would be executed. And the last one, P2, would be executed. And it requires 3 unit of time. So 12 plus 3 is equal to 15. Yes, it is very simple to plot, Gantt chart. If you are talking about, non-primitive scheduling algorithm. But it is somewhat difficult when you are dealing with primitive priority scheduling algorithm. Or as a primitive SJF algorithm. Yes, because we need to do a context switching, we need to check every time after executing that process for 1 unit of time. Yes, so that we will see in the later slide. So based on this Gantt chart, again we can calculate the turnaround time, waiting time for each process, and then we can calculate the average waiting time of all the processes. Okay, so let us discuss that stuff. And time, how we can find out, we can easily find out with help of Gantt chart. That you know very well. Okay, so based the first four columns are as it is. Turnaround time of a P1 process is exit time minus arrival time. So 4 minus 0, arrival time is 0. It is 4. Waiting time of P1 is what? Turnaround time, which is 4, and minus burst time. Burst time is nothing but 4. So 4 minus 4 is equal to 0. So in this way, you can calculate the turnaround time and waiting time for each process. And once you calculate these things, now you can easily calculate the average waiting time. So average waiting time, what is the formula? Average waiting time is equal to sum of waiting time of all the processes divided by number of processes. So 4, 0 plus 11 plus 9 plus 1 plus 5 divided by 5 is equal to 5.2. So average waiting time of non-primitive priority based scheduling algorithm based on these input is 5.2 unit. Okay, now let us discuss what will be the average waiting time for primitive priority based scheduling algorithm. So in the case of primitive priority based algorithm, again we are taking same set of inputs. Yes. So same table I have carried forward over here, and according to this table, what is inputs? Let us see of the Gantt chart of printing priority rings algorithm. So in this case, we need to carefully execute this task. So at time 0, how many processes we have? Only one, which is nothing but P1. So P1 is scheduled for execution in the CPU. Yes. So P1 will be scheduled first, and we will execute P1 for 1 minute of time only. Because it is printing, so we need to check, is there at 1 minute of time, is there any other process arriving in the ready queue? The answer is yes. So if any other process arrive in the ready queue, so we need to check, we need to compare the priority of newly arrived process with the priority of ongoing process. If priority of newly arrived process is higher than the ongoing process, in that case we need to do a context switching. So the same stuff is happening over here. See, P1 is executed for 1 minute of time at one time, P2 is around, yes. So before going to continue, we need to check the priority of P2. P2's priority is 3, and ongoing process, which is nothing but P1, priority is 2. So P2 priority is higher than P1. So P2 need to be scheduled first. So again, P2 will be scheduled for 1 minute of time, and at time 2, again we need to check, is there any other newly arrived process? If answer is yes, yes, in this case, answer is yes, P3 is arrived. Now we need to check the priority of P3 as well. So P3's priority is higher than the ongoing process, yes. So again, we need to context switch to P3. So P3 will be scheduled for execution and will be executed for 1 minute of time. We need to check at time 3. Is there any other process arrived? Yes, P4 is arrived. We need to check the priority of P4. P4 priority is higher than the existing process priority. So again, we need to context switch to P4. P4 will be executed for 1 minute of time. Again, at time 4, we need to check. Is there any other process arrived? Yes. At P4, P5, process is arrived in the ready queue. But we need to check the priority number of that process. So which is 5. And the priority of P5 means what? Newly arrived process and ongoing process is same. So as I told you, to break the time, what will happen? What will you do? We need to check the arrival time of these two processes, and according to the seniority, we will schedule the process for execution. So in this case, senior most process is P4. Okay, because P4 arrival time is 3 and P5 arrival time is 4. Yes, so P4 will continue its execution. Okay, and at time 5, now we don't want to check the arrival time, because at time 4, all the processes arrived in the ready queue. Now, this example will be converted into a non-printing type of algorithm. So now we need to schedule the process according to the priority only. And once you schedule the process, you will finish its execution. Yes? So P4 will complete its execution. Okay? Then, next highest priority is P5. So P5 will be scheduled and P5 will be executed for 2 minutes of time. Yes. Now P5 has completed its task. Now what about your remaining process? Okay. Now P3 is already executed. Now the remaining processes are P2 and P1. So P2 and P1, if you compare the priority number, so P2 priority number is higher than the priority of your P1. So P2 will be scheduled for execution. And how much time it requires? So remaining time, because P2 was scheduled earlier and it was executed for 1 minute of time. So now the remaining time of P2 is 2 units. So P2 in this case, P2 will be scheduled or is executed for 2 units of time or instead of 3. So these things you have to keep in mind. People are doing mistake in this particular step. Okay, so P2 would be executed. So 10 plus 2 is equal to 12. Now the last one, P1. Again, P1 was executed earlier for 1 minute of time. first time of P1 is 3. So P1 would be executed for 3 units of time. So 12 plus 3 is equal to 15. So in this way you can plot the Gantt chart, and now based on this Gantt chart and by having the end exit time of each process, we can easily calculate the turnaround time and waiting time for each process. So let us discuss a table in which we can easily calculate these values. Okay. So as far as P1 process is concerned, turnaround time is equal to exit time minus arrival time. Exit time of P1 is 15 minus arrival is 0. So it's equal to 15 is turnaround time of P1 process. Same way, waiting time you can calculate 15 minus loss time 4 is equal to 11. So in this way you can calculate the turnaround time and waiting time for each process, and once you find out these values, based on the waiting time for each process, you can easily calculate the average waiting time of all the processes. Okay, so 11 plus 8 plus 0 plus 0 plus 4 divided by how many processes we have? 5. So is equal to 4.6. This is the average waiting time of preemptive priority scheduling algorithm. Okay, so now once you understand the concept of non-preemptive and preemptive priority scheduling algorithm, now we are going to discuss the advantages of priority-based CPU scheduling algorithm. So it provides a facility of priorities especially for system processes. So where such type of algorithms can be implemented? So there are two types of processes we have in operating system. One is operating system processes and second one is user processes. That are, this concept I have already told you in the previous session, but still it required to explain in this case. So there are two types of processes, and operating system processes have generally higher priority as compared to user processes. One, for example, one process we have which is associated with, you know, operating system, like say for example if one process which is maintaining the temperature of the CPU. Okay, so if this is nothing but, you know, operating system oriented process, and if this, you can imagine, if this process do not give the higher priority as compared to user process, what will happen after some amount of time? Okay, user cannot able to execute the task. Because if system temperature is not maintained on regular interval, you can imagine after some time that machine would not be operating. Yes, it might be dead after some time. So that such type of process requires a higher priority. So in such type of cases, we need to give the higher priority as compared to the user processes. So in this environment, in this type of applications, we need to use priority-based CPU scheduling algorithm. Okay. Second advantage is it allows to run important process first, even if it is a user process. Even though it is user process, sometimes, you know, it happens if user process is very important. Yes, if you are calculating, you know, say for example, if you are doing, you know, online transaction, so in that case, that process, and if you are doing, you know very well there is a, you know, time limit up to fixed period of time, your transaction would remain active. Yes, so during that period of time, user process needs to give highest priority. Okay, and because it requires, you know, few seconds or is it very few minutes to complete the transaction. So if such type of, you know, scenario is there, again this algorithm can be useful. So these are the advantages of, you know, priority based algorithm. Now what are the disadvantages of priority based algorithm? So here process which smaller priority may start for the CPU. Again, as we have discussed in SGF, it suffers from starvation. Same way, these algorithms, priority-based CPU scheduling algorithm suffers from starvation. Why? Because in this case, CPU is biased also. Why? Because we are not scheduling the process according to the arrival time. We are scheduling the process based on priority only. Nothing else we are considering. We are not considering burst time, we are not considering arrival time as well. Okay, to schedule the process. So based on the priority, we are simply scheduling the processes for execution. So there is again a clear cut, you know, partiality. So if there is a partiality, definitely starvation will be present. Okay, but how to avoid the starvation? So there is one technique we have called aging. So aging is a technique of gradually increasing the priority of a processes that wait in the system for a long period of time. So what will happen? To avoid this starvation, what is starvation? If a process entered into a ready queue and its priority is very small, okay, or if it contains least priority, so what will happen? That process will never get a chance to execute in the CPU. So it means what, it is waiting in a ready queue for a long period of time. So to avoid this problem, because this is the responsibility of operating system, if process arrive in the ready queue, now there is a responsibility of operating system to execute that process anyhow in this view. So to avoid the long waiting time, what we can do is we can use this aging technique, and what it tells us, after a fixed period of time, suppose if we have a least priority process in ready queue and we do not get chance to execute in the CPU for a long period of time, so what we can do is to avoid this problem after a fixed interval of time. Say for example after 5 minutes, after every 5 minutes, okay, if this process do not have chance to execute in the CPU and still it is in waiting mode, so what we will do, after 5 minutes we will increase the priority of that process by 1. Again, we will wait for 5 minutes and check, is there any chance to execute this process in the CPU? Still it is not executing, it is in waiting mode. Yes, so in that case again, after 5 minutes again we will increase the priority of that process by 1. In this way, we are gradually increasing the priority of that process, and at a particular moment of time, definitely this process will have a chance to execute in the CPU. So in this way, we can avoid the situation of starvation, and that technique is nothing but aging. Okay, so I hope it was clear to you. Thanks for watching this video. See you in the next one.